Icon Audio Arts.
Seems to be ready.
Are you ready?
For the next band.
We're sorry for the delay. Is
everybody ready?
Well, they've done the West Coast, they've done all sorts of other places in America, the biggest gathering in New York. The first one in 3 years, the Rolling Stones. The Rolling Stones.
The greatest rock and roll band in the world, the Rolling Stones.
Charlie Watts is one of the greatest drummers the world has ever going to see.
It's better than the worst, isn't it?
From Wembley, Charlie Watts!
Worked 5 years and 20 years hanging around.
Looking at the life I've led, very nice and very privileged, really. I mean, I get paid very well for doing what I love doing, you know? The problem with the Rolling Stones is that they became so popular that you kind of saw them in the newspaper as opposed to how I knew them, you know.
The most adulation I get is Hello Charlie.
Keith is a friend of mine, and that's one thing, but the Rolling Stones are a whole nother thing. I know it's as much him and me, but I've always kept it a long way away from me. A, because I never really believed it all, to be honest with you, and I feel happier that way. The Rolling Stones finish when the curtain closes. And I've always been like that, even when I used to hate cars chasing you down the road. I mean, it's a bit flattering than that, but I used to actually hate it.
Charlie's good tonight, isn't he?
We've got some breaking news this hour in the world of music. Charlie Watts, the drummer of the Rolling Stones, has died. His publicist just announced that Watts passed away peacefully in a London hospital earlier today, surrounded by his family. In June, he had a medical procedure for some unknown condition. Earlier this month, Watts announced he would not tour with the Stones.
Watts had been a member of the band since 1963. He had turned 80 in June. Charlie was a cherished husband, father and grandfather, and also as a member of the Rolling Stones, one of the greatest drummers of his generation, Doherty added in a statement. We kindly request that the prime of his family, most essential members and close friends is respected at this difficult time.
Charlie Robert Watts was born on June 2, 1941. He was, of course, an English drummer best known as a member of the Rolling Stones from 1963 until his death in August of 2021. Charlie was originally trained as a graphic artist. He started playing drums in London's rhythm and blues clubs, where he met Brian Jones, Mick Jagger, and Keith Richards. In January of 1963, he joined their fledgling group, the Rolling Stones, as drummer, while doubling as a designer of their record sleeves and tour stages. Watts was the only Rolling Stone, other than Jagger or Richards, to have been featured on all of their studio albums. He toured with his own group, the Charlie Watts Quintet, and often appeared in London at Ronnie Scott's Jazz Club. In 2006, Watts was elected into the Modern Drummer Hall of Fame. In the same year, Vanity Fair elected him to the International Best Dressed List Hall of Fame. In the estimation of noted music critic Robert Christou, Watts was rock's greatest drummer. In 2016, he was ranked 12th on Rolling Stone's 100 Greatest Drummers of All Time. Charlie was born at University College Hospital in Bloomsbury, London, to Charles Richard Watts, a lorry driver for the London Midland and Scottish Railroad, and his wife, Lillian Charlotte Nee Eaves. He had one sister, Linda. As a child, Watts lived in Wembley at 23 Pilgrim's Way. Many of Wembley's houses had been destroyed by German bombs during World War II. Watts and his family lived in a prefab, as did many in the community. Charlie's neighbor, Dave Green, who lived opposite, was a childhood friend, and they remained close. Green recalls that as boys, we discovered 78 RPM records. Charlie had more records than I did. We used to go into Charlie's bedroom and just get these records out. Watts's earliest records were all jazz. He remembered owning 78 RPM records of Jelly Roll Morton and Charlie Parker. Green recalls that Watts had The One with Monk and Johnny Dodge. Charlie was ahead of me in listening, and acquisitions as well. Watts and his family subsequently moved to Kingsbury, where he attended Taylor's Croft Secondary Modern School from 1952 to 1956. As a schoolboy, he displayed a talent for art, music, cricket, and football. When he and Green were both about 13, Watts became interested in drumming. Charlie's loving parents gave him his first drum kit in 1955, and he would practice drumming along with jazz records in the front parlor of the family home. After completing secondary school, Watts enrolled at Harrow Art School, now the Harrow campus of the University of Westminster, which he attended until 1960. After leaving, he worked as a graphic designer for an advertising company called Charlie Daniels Studios, and also played drums occasionally with local bands in coffee shops and clubs. He and budding bassist Green began their musical careers together from 1958 to 1959, playing a jazz band in Middlesex called the Joe Jones All-Stars. I went into rhythm and blues, but when they asked me to play, I didn't know what it was. I thought it meant Charlie Parker playing very slow. In 1961, Watts met Alexis Corner, who invited him to join his band, Blues Incorporated. At that time, Watts was on the way to a sojourn working as a graphic designer in Denmark, but he accepted Corner's offer when he returned to London in February of 1962. Charlie played regularly with Blues Incorporated and maintained a job with another advertising firm of Charles, Hobson, and Gray. It was in 1962 that Watts first met Brian Jones, Ian Stewart, Mick Jagger, and Keith Richards, who also frequented the London Rhythm and Blues clubs. But it was not until January of 1963 that Watts finally agreed to join the Rolling Stones. Besides his music, Charlie contributed graphic art and comic strips to the early Rolling Stones records, such as Between the Buttons, and was responsible for the 1975 tour announcement press conference in New York City. The band surprised the throng of waiting reporters by driving and playing Brown Sugar on the back of a flatbed truck in the middle of Manhattan traffic. Watts had remembered that this was a common way for New Orleans jazz bands to promote upcoming dates. Moreover, with Jagger, he designed the elaborate stages for tours, first contributing to the lotus-shaped design for their 1975 Tour of the Americas, as well as the 1989-1990 Steel Wheels Urban Jungle Tour, the 1997-98 Bridges to Babylon Tour, the 2002-2003 Licks Tour, and the 2005-2007 A Bigger Bang Tour. Watts was involved in many activities outside his life as a member of the Rolling Stones. In 1964, he published a cartoon tribute to Charlie Parker entitled Ode to a High-Flying Bird. Although he made his name in rock, his personal taste lay principally in jazz. In the late 1970s, he joined Ian Stewart in the Back to the Roots boogie-woogie band Rocket 88, which featured many of the UK's top jazz, rock, and R&B musicians. In the 1980s, he toured worldwide with a big band that included such names as Evan Parker, Courtney Pine, and Jack Bruce, who was also a member of Rocket 88. In 1991, he organized a jazz quintet as another tribute to Charlie Parker, while 1993 saw the release of Warm and Tender by the Charlie Watts Quintet, which included vocalist Bernard Fowler. This same group then released Long Ago and Far Away in 1996. Both records included a collection of great American songbook standards. After a successful collaboration with Jim Keltner on the Rolling Stones' Bridges to Babylon, Watts and Keltner released a techno instrumental album simply entitled Charlie Watts, Jim Keltner Project. Watts stated that even though the tracks bore such names as the Elvin Suite in honor of the late Elvin Jones, Max Roach, and Roy Hayes, they were not copying their style of drumming, but rather capturing a feeling by those great artists. Watts at Scott's was recorded with the group the Charlie Watts Tintet at the famous jazz club in London, Ronnie Scott's. In April of 2009, he started to perform concerts with the A, B, C, and D of Boogie Woogie, together with Ben Waters, plus his childhood friend, Dave Green, on bass. In 1989, the Rolling Stones were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. In the July 2006 issue of Modern Drummer magazine, Watts was voted into the Modern Drummer Hall of Fame, joining Ringo Starr, Keith Moon, Steve Gadd, and Buddy Rich, as well as other highly esteemed and influential drummers from the history of rock and jazz. In the estimation of many, Charlie was perhaps rock's greatest drummer, but undeniably to everyone, he was a gentleman, an artist, and a friend. To everyone he met, and everyone he touched with his music. We'll miss you, Charlie. Part 2.
Before the advent of the Rolling Stones, there were just two slightly inarticulate little geezers from Dartford, Kent, called Mick Jagger and Keith Richard. Although they were schoolboy friends, they didn't really connect until a chance encounter in 1960 at Dartford Railway Station while awaiting the morning train to London. Still at a loss concerning his professional future, Richard was treading water, ostensibly studying advertising at Sidcup Art College, while young Mick, or Mike as he was known in those days, was intent upon a business career. Attending the prestigious London School of Economics, Jagger was a capable student who, in accord with his newfound mate Keith, shared a deep liking for the native blues of the American South. It's strange, remembers Richard, concerning his early association with the gawky Jagger. I knew Mick when I was really young, 5, 6, or 7. We used to hang out together, but then I moved and I didn't see him for a long time. I once met him selling ice creams outside the public library. I bought one. He was trying to make some extra money. Musically, the two teens had a lot to talk about. From those first awkward moments together on the Southern Line, it was Mick's collection of hard-to-find rhythm and blues albums from the States that held sway. Poles apart, even today, in temperament, Messrs. Jagger and Richard went on to become firm friends, hanging out, rapping, and above all, absorbing the gut-wrenching blues that cemented the lifelong bond between them. From the moment Keith got it into his head that he wanted to play guitar, he was hooked. Posing seductively in front of the bathroom mirror, he would pout and prance like the real rockers he saw on the telly, getting down the moves, as he put it, long before he ever touched the instrument. Mick, too, was determined to make his mark as a performer, writing a letter to blues man Alexis Corner in 1962, requesting a spot on the bill at the Ealing Jazz Club in West London. Ginger Baker, latter-day Cream percussionist and Corner's drummer, remembers those first uncertain gigs as horrific, complaining that the pubescent Jagger was not only a very tentative singer, but almost completely devoid of any discernible stage presence or charisma.
Sitting on the stage in the first set and coming down in the bus, I'd noticed this young chap with us. To me, somewhat effeminate-looking young fellow. And during the gig, he sat on a chair between my hi-hat and Jack's amp. Right, so Jack's here, there's this guy sat here and I'm there. So we're playing away and he sat there and I've become aware of him and I'm stoned. So I've leant across to Jack, right across, there's this kid sitting there. Who the fuck is this, Jack? It's Jagger, only I don't know him from anybody. He's a friend of Alexis, you see. So it's Jagger. And like at the end of the set, he stands up and sings a number with Ronnie Jones. And that's it, you know.
What'd you think?
Yeah, it's all right. So the next gig we did is the Ealing Club, where Mick Jagger turns up with Brian Jones, and they're going to do the interval.
Just the two of them?
That's the whole point. Alexis Corner, who is the most charming fellow the world has ever known, with his BBC accent, and he was Alexis could talk you into anything. Alexis chatted me, Jack, and Johnny Parker into doing the interval with Mick and Brian. Now, I wasn't at all pleased by this arrangement, as you can imagine, because it meant I didn't get my fix in the interval, right? It meant I just went straight through the gig before I could have a fix again. You know, doing two sets and a set in the middle. So, me and Jack were like, we did it because Alexis had asked us to, and Alexis was was paying the money. You know, we started playing. Mick's trying to do these sort of straight blues things, and Jack and I are playing very intricate jazz type rhythms behind, you see. Such an effect was this having, like none of us playing on the first beat of the bar, nobody playing on the one, you see. Left young Mick Jagger unable to figure out where he was. So Brian, however, was a pretty hip guy, Brian. And Brian would be shouting to Mick Jagger, 1, 2, 3, 4, telling him where the beat was, you see. So I was quite impressed with Brian in that, you know, he was like, he could suss what we were doing. Anyway, I was not at all happy with this arrangement, so the following week when it happened, I said after the gig to Brian, who by this time I got on fine with him, You know, Mick didn't talk to me. He didn't come anywhere near me, right? Except to look at me askance, you know, because he couldn't work it. He didn't know what I was playing at all. He couldn't understand it. Brian could, so obviously Brian, I got on well with him. So I said, Brian, for fuck's sake, get a rhythm section, man. You know, give us a break. Like, literally, you know. So the next week...
You were the first Rolling Stones drummer.
That was before they were the Rolling Stones.
What were they called?
They weren't called anything then.
It was Brian and Mick.
It was just Brian and Mick with the, you know, playing in the interval for the Alexis Corner Band. Because Mick was, you know, very close to Alexis. Alexis was like, sort of, he was Alexis's sort of like protege. So the following week, they turned up with a rhythm section, which was the worst thing about it. And I only heard the last half of the last number, apart from what I could hear in the cars, and I was too busy having a fix to worry about what was going on. But I came back and, like, Brian come up to me. Like, we were going back on stage and Brian's coming off, and he come up to me and said, you know, what did you think? So I said, yeah, cool, but I said, the drummer, man, he's awful. Why don't you get Charlie Watts? And which is exactly what they did.
What's the story you told me about Charlie Watts saying, I don't want to, not even sure I want to be a musician?
No, he mentioned to me and Dick when he left the band so I could join it, that he didn't really want to be involved in music because it was too insecure a business, you know. It was like, you know, too risky an enterprise, if you like. But anyway, the next thing that happened was Brian said to me, we've got a gig down at the Cy Laurie Club. Well, the Cy Laurie Club was on Windmill Street, right close to Archer Street. And it was a club down in the basement. The Cy Laurie Club was a big sort of club there. And they'd got a gig down there, and it was all like cinema seats in the thing. And Jack and I went along to hear the band. This was a Stones' very first gig, I think. I suspect it was the very first gig they ever did as a Stones. And at this time, Mick was just standing at the microphone singing. Maybe he was tapping his foot, but that's all he was moving. Brian, however, was doing what Jimi Hendrix did, like, when he sat in with Cream, which was sometime later, but he was doing all this showmanship thing, right? Brian was, like, playing, laying on his back, playing, and at one point he jumped off the stage into the crowd and was playing like that. And, like, Jack and I were stood there and, like, we thought the music laughable, really, you know, from where we were coming from. It was like young kids trying to play and, you know, doing a reasonable job of it. But we both saw immediately it was commercial as hell, because it was just that rawness, that lack of musicianship that put that edge on the music that made it so popular. It was like that raw sort of thing. Like, for us, it was like, you know, bad musicianship, but for everybody else, it was something raw and wonderful. We saw there what it was. But the funny thing was that it was Brian Jones that was doing all the showmanship thing, and Jagger got it from Brian Jones. I think Brian Jones was an enormous effect on Jagger, on what Jagger became. Was his relationship with Brian Jones. Brian Jones was a very together guy and really very responsible for how big the Stones became. Brian was like one half of it for sure. In fact, I think history has been a little reticent in owning up to, you know. And that was the Rolling Stones.
By now, this first feeble incarnation of the Stones, known briefly as Little Boy Blue and the Blue Boys, were an ad hoc collective consisting of Keith on guitar, Mick on vocals, and Dick Taylor, a reasonably experienced semi-pro bassman from Bexley Heath, Kent. All that was to change, however, when, on April 7th, 1962, they ran headlong into pixie-ish guitarist Brian Jones while gigging in Ealing. tearing into a red-hot rendition of Dust My Blues, Jones growled a terse good evening to the whipped-up crowd, introducing himself as Elmo Lewis, after his musical hero, Elmore James. Brian had originally set his sights on becoming a dentist, but later switched gears significantly by embracing music as a career. Trained on the piano from the age of 6, Jones moved on to clarinet and finally, upon leaving school, the guitar. At 17, Brian jetted off to the continent, trekking through several European countries before returning home to Cheltenham, briefly before finally moving down to London with his leggy girlfriend, Pat Andrews, to pursue his art. Following Brian's initial meeting with Mick and Keith, he invited them to drop by an upcoming gig at a Soho pub, where Richard was introduced to Ian Stewart, then playing piano for Jones. "He blew my mind," says Keith. "I never heard a white piano like that before. Real Albert Ammons stuff." Rehearsing together for the first time over the Bricklayer's Arms on Broadwick Street in Soho, Jones even had a name for the fledgling group, the Rolling Stones, after Muddy Waters' Rolling Stone Blues. Stone-faced drummer Charlie Watts first picked up the sticks at 14 after his parents bought him his own elementary set for Christmas that year. Playing along to jazz records in the front parlor, Watts dreamed of one day heading up his own big band. Rock and roll at that point was still just a faraway sound drifting in offshore from Radio Luxembourg late at night as Charlie lay listening in bed. Joining Alexis Corner in 1962, Charlie first jammed with Keith and Mick at the Ealing Jazz Club, performing Chuck Berry's Around and Around. Although they received only sporadic applause that evening, they had connected musically. Ironically, it was to be another 5 full months until the reserved percussionist would relent and officially come on board as the Rolling Stones' one and only drummer. By September 1962, Dick Taylor had effectively called it quits as a Rolling Stone, going on to study at the Royal College of Art. Without missing a beat, Brian placed an ad in the music press announcing the vacancy. On a snowy December 7th, 26-year-old technician Bill Perks, known professionally as Bill Wyman, auditioned for the band at the Wetherby Arms in Chelsea. Although the other band members weren't all that impressed with Bill's even, unexciting working-class persona, they were thrilled with his top-drawer equipment, including a new amp, spare Vox AC-30, as well as a booming speaker system. The only married Stone, Wyman enjoyed a level of comfort and stability the other boys could only imagine. Mick, Keith, and Brian were almost always broke. Charlie still lived at home with his parents, and so was still quite well fed, prompting the compassionate bassist to regularly escort the band down to the local Wimpy Bar for a utilitarian meal of egg and chips. "I still get the shivers whenever I see a tin of cold spaghetti," Brian Jones once remarked, "and that was a treat. A lot of the time we lived on whatever we could concoct from flour and water." Despite the group's lack of finances, they were slowly building a steady following amongst the rough-and-ready teenage population of Richmond and Twickenham. Playing nightly for months on end, the 6 amiable musicians, including Ian Stewart, were stretched to the limit with a back-breaking routine of 5-hour gigs that saw them appearing at such offbeat venues as the Corn Exchange in Wisbech, the Richmond Athletic Club, private parties for Britain's upper-crust gentry, and even a 2-day stint at a suburban London fairground. Happily, the group's hard work was beginning to pay off. A Rolling Stones fan club was formed with over 300 members, and individual chapters for each of the boys. Tom Keelock, the Stones' towering convivial chauffeur-cum-road manager, remembers his early involvement with the band.
"I owned a car hire company out in London, and I got a phone call to pick them up. And I thought, Rolling Stones, who are they? And, anyway, I sent one of my chauffeurs on the job. He came back and said, 'Never again. I'm not driving them anymore, they're all mad.' So, he threatened to quit the job, or I go. So I turned up and, well, it was a real hassle, really. But I got it together. I got them straightened out a little bit, like, keep your feet off the windows and the upholstery, and stop throwing cigarette ends all over the place. And one thing led to another, and done a tour with them. And from there, Keith said, 'Well, why don't you sell out and work with us?'"
Here, Keelock recalls the divergent personalities of the 3 chief forces within the Stones, starting with Mick Jagger.
"I thought he was the the more stable one of the of them. Keith, bit of a hard man, but I find out different over the years. Brian, he was a genius. He could play anything. He really had a feeling for when he played it. It was whole. His whole body or his whole mind was into it, you know?
As time went on, the Rolling Stones became something of a national treasure in Britain among the young. There was still the rest of the world, however, to be convinced. Despite their achievements at home, the Stones couldn't really feel they'd made it until the inevitable trip stateside to try their luck in the all-important American market. Without the States, Brian Jones remarked at the time, we're just five louts from the suburbs with a local record deal and a van full of tatty equipment. England's newest Hitmakers, the band's first American album, was issued in the States in May 1964, with the boys following shortly thereafter to commence an ambitious tour. The group's first gig in San Bernardino was a knockout, with the capacity crowd of screaming young women in bliss over the spirited performance of their shaggy heroes. Not so, however, elsewhere as the tour rolled on to San Antonio and a disappointing turnout of about 200 kids in a 19,000-seat venue. Returning home to England on June 23rd, the Stones were met at Heathrow Airport by thousands of screaming fans, helping to heal the degrading spectacle of their first American tour. 3 days later, Decca released their fourth single, It's All Over Now, backed by Good Times, Bad Times. By now, the Rolling Stones had become something of a national obsession in England, a kind of anti-Christ Beatles, hell-bent on breaking down the barriers between the old guard stuffiness of their parents' generation and replacing it with a freer, more experimental, less disciplined approach to life. At least, that's what Andrew Oldham would have you believe. For Mick and the boys, though, rock and roll was still basically just a way to beat the dole. When we saw how successful the Beatles were early on, says Jagger, we thought, oh, there's a good job. World travel, screaming women, nice clothes, fast cars, lots of spare cash. Yep, that's the job for us. On October 23rd, 1964, the Stones flew to New York to begin their second American tour. One interesting phenomena relating to the Stones in America was the fact that while so many young men found the Beatles' overt cuteness and saccharine delivery a little too wimpy, the Rolling Stones' musical rough stuff was considered right on. Oftentimes, upon arriving at an airport, it would be the guys standing front and center holding signs and even mimicking Jagger's famous two-foot shuffle for the excited teen queens who swooned at their feet. America's male population was quickly finding that looking even vaguely like one's heroes wasn't a bad way to gain the attention of the opposite sex. Suddenly, all over the globe, barbershops were reporting an across-the-board slowing of business. During a press conference in New York, Jagger commented on how the producers of the Ed Sullivan Show bleeped out the phrase, trying to make some girl, during the group's appearance on the legendary presenter's Really Big Shoe.
They blocked the vocal out because they allowed us to say the words, and then when we said the words, they blocked it out. But, you know, I mean, it doesn't really matter, you know. It's all a joke. I mean, it's a washing machine, and then it's you, and then it's a soap powder. I mean, what does it really matter, you know?
Here Mick is questioned as to his current state of satisfaction.
Are you any more satisfied now as far as...
Do you mean sexually or philosophically?
Both.
Yeah, we're more satisfied now sexually.
Philosophically and financially?
Financially dissatisfied, sexually satisfied, philosophically trying.
As time went by, the Beatles and the Stones became increasingly tight. Prior to issuing a new single, Jagger would invariably ring McCartney so that the two might coordinate their release dates, thus avoiding confusion amongst the teeny boppers over which fab new record to buy. Mixing business with pleasure, the Beatles and the Stones actually spent quite a lot of time together over the years. Mick, for instance, showed up at the taping of the Beatles' appearance on the international broadcast of Our World in 1967, where they performed the classic All You Need Is Love, as well as tagging along to spend a contemplative weekend with the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi and assorted fabs in Bangor, Wales that same year. Ruth McCartney, Paul's ultra-talented younger sister, looks back on Mick Jagger's relationship with her celebrated big brother.
I don't remember the first time I met Mick, but he, I mean, they were sort of constantly coming, drifting in and out of the house, and he was just, you know, kind of nervous and hanging out, and obviously didn't want to go to the Bag of Nails or the clubs or the, you know, the be seen about town things, and certainly didn't want to sit in his flat because the police were all parked outside waiting for him to make a wrong move. So he, you know, he would come over and hang with Paul, and they'd go upstairs and play music and, you know, commiserate and do whatever it is that rock stars do.
By this time, the Stones had been introduced to the illicit pleasures of not only speed and drink, but cannabis as well. Always a big party band, the boys applied themselves admirably to their own personal pursuit of happiness, with Brian and Keith as the musical collective's naughtiest alumni. On February 12th, 15 police officers mounted a surprise raid at Keith Richards' home in response to an anonymous tip indicating that the Stones were holding a drug orgy. It just so happened that we had all taken acid and were in a completely freaked out state when the police arrived, says Richard. There was a big knock at the door. Everybody was just sort of gliding down slowly from the whole day of freaking about. The TV was on with the sound off, and the record player was on. Strobe lights were flickering. Marianne had just decided that she wanted a bath and had wrapped herself up in a rug and was watching the box. Bang, 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 there's this big knock at the door, and I went to answer it. Oh, look, there's lots of little ladies and gentlemen outside. Sitting on the Chesterfield, nude except for the big furry rug, Marianne was far too stoned to actually fathom the seriousness of what was going on. She remembers, through my acid haze, I remember being amazed at the number of policemen who had crowded into the room, 18 or 19 of them. Three of them were policewomen who I guess had come to search me. By the time the police had succeeded in rampaging through Keith's home, they had come up with only 4 amphetamine tablets in a jacket belonging to Marianne, which Jagger claimed was his and so was subsequently charged for possession of a dangerous drug. Richard was busted for allowing his estate, Redlands, to be used for the purpose of smoking cannabis resin. The naked, tripped-out Marianne Faithful, referred to as Miss X in the press and throughout the trial, was not charged. On May 10th, a similar raid was mounted at Brian Jones' flat in South Kensington, London, resulting in both Jones and his mate, Prince Stanislaus Klausowski, being hauled down to Chelsea Police Station and charged with possession of cannabis. When Keith and Mick finally went to trial at Chichester Crown Court in West Sussex on June 27th, 1967, the press pointed their reporting to some very abstract avenues of inquiry. Pop idol Mick Jagger went to court today in a lime green jacket, read one newspaper, a green and black tie, floral patterned white shirt, and olive green pinstripe trousers to answer drug accusations. Keith's fashion sense, too, came under scrutiny. Deliberating for only 5 minutes, the jury found Mick guilty. Accordingly, Judge Block refused bail and remanded the obviously shaken Jagger to immediate police custody. The next morning, it was Keith's turn on the hot seat, with Prosecutor Morris, bolstered by the previous day's easy win, diving in with both feet. Richard's defense, aptly handled by legal luminary Lord Michael Havers, centered on the fact that a hanger-on named Paul Schneiderman was the only person actually found with any cannabis on his person the evening of the raid. Richard's contention was that if any doper indeed smoked that weekend, it was without his knowledge and consent, and therefore he should not be held culpable. Unfortunately, the jury didn't buy it, and after deliberating for less than an hour, found the famous defendant guilty as charged. Richard was given 1 year in jail and a £500 fine. Jagger fared a little better with a 3-month term and £100 in cost. As the issue gained the impossible momentum of a full-fledged international incident, even the normally staid Times published a pro-Stones editorial. Following their release on bail, £7,000, Jagger and Richard filed the appropriate appeals, and on July 31st, 1967, their cases were heard. Although Keith was unable to attend due to an unexpected case of chickenpox, Mick turned up sporting a somber dark business suit and a thin black tie. Although Jagger's original conviction was upheld, the judge ruled the original sentence excessive and altered Jagger's sentence to 1 year's probation. Turning then to the case against Richard, the Chief Justice found that the evidence against him was both circumstantial and inconclusive and overturned the finding of the lower court. Intertwined in all of this was the little-known fact that upon sentencing Richard, Judge Block referred to him as scum and filth and people like you. The next legal hurdle to be overcome was the pending drugs charge against Brian Jones. Appearing at the Inner London Sessions on October 30th, Jones looked very frail as he mounted the steps to the witness box to hear the charges read against him. Entering a guilty plea to the offense of smoking cannabis, and yet another for allowing his residence to be used for unlawful purposes, the lonely stone was then exonerated of two further charges of possession of cocaine and methadrine. Assured by his solicitors that by pleading guilty to the two less serious charges he would be given probation and perhaps a small fine, Jones was shattered when the judge solemnly pronounced his decision to commit the accused to Wormwood Scrubs for a 9-month term. Ordered to commence serving his time immediately, Jones was shackled and led away. Fortunately, the sentence was reversed upon appeal, replaced instead by a £1,000 fine and 3 years probation. Roadman Keelock recalls the amusing aftermath of the admittedly nerve-wracking trial.
During the court case, this is really funny. I couldn't believe it. The court ordered he must go to the psychiatrist, but their one of their choosing, not one of ours, like, you know. And I took him to a hospital in Holloway Road, when I originally was born not far from there, so I knew it. So he said, "You're not going to leave me, are you?" I said, "Well, I won't leave it, but he won't let me in there." So I took him there, so yes. So I waited outside the door. After about 3/4 hour, the door opened, and this psychiatrist says, "Would you do me a favour, Mr. Keelock? Take him away, because I was going to make an appointment with my psychiatrist." So going down the hallway, Brian said, "That's it, that done his brain in, didn't it?" I said, "Brian, what are you doing?" He was witty sometimes, very witty, Brian, sometimes.
Without doubt, the biggest professional disappointment for the Stones in 1968 was the failure, in their eyes anyway, of their ambitious TV movie spectacular, The Rock and Roll Circus. The concept behind the film was mind-boggling. The Stones would gather together the cream of rock's landed gentry to join with the band in front of a live audience for an evening of great music and over-the-top theatrics with an old-time circus theme. Amongst the superstar guests were John Lennon and Yoko Ono, Eric Clapton, Jethro Tull, The Who, Mitch Mitchell, Taj Mahal, and Marianne Faithfull. Ironically, the only problem the Stones had was with their own performance, which, according to Bill Wyman, didn't really measure up musically. The dawn of the new year, 1969, beckoned in the darkest era yet for the Rolling Stones. On June 8th, the Stones, minus Bill, met at Brian's new country estate, Cotchford Farm, the former residence of Winnie the Pooh creator A.A. Milne, to try and diplomatically advise him that his services were no longer required by the group. Brian was predictably crushed, but was so generally out of it at the time that he hardly said a word, later agreeing to issue a generic statement to the press citing a change in musical direction as the reason. Ever the master statesman, Jagger too was anxious that the media understand that there were no hard feelings between the parties and that the split was both inevitable and amiable. "The only solution to our problem was for Brian to leave us," said Mick. "He wants to play music which is more his own rather than always playing ours. We have decided that it is best for him to be free to follow his own inclinations. We have parted on the best of terms. We will continue to be friends, and we're certainly going to meet socially in the future. There's no question of us breaking up a friendship. Friendships like ours just don't break up like that." Despite the many difficulties within the group, Tom Keelock insists that throughout it all, the other Stones held a deep regard for the troubled Brian.
When he was in a bit of a state, Keith should say, "Look, don't worry about me. You get me a car, pick me up and whatever, go look after him, like, you know. Keep your eye on him." I don't think they hated him. I mean, it's very difficult to hate anybody that you've worked and lived with. They had quite a lot against him back in the early days, like, you know, him taking most of the bread and all that, lying to him. And they didn't think too much of that. I don't think Keith had ever forgot that. But, you know, when you say hate him, somebody told me, Keith, about a lot of people would have liked him dead. I can't really see that myself, you know. Didn't like him, and how can you wish anybody dead?
Dennis Burke, at that time one of the youngest publicans in all of Britain, ran the Hay Wagon pub in Brian's adopted home of Hartfield, Sussex. He recalls the complicated young man who would eventually become a dear friend.
Brian used to frequent the public house. He was nothing but charming. He was a man with problems. He was a man that...
What kind of problems?
Well, problems in as much as that he was probably a weak character, in as much as that he needed support from other people and from alcohol.
Did he drink to excess?
Yes, yes.
Way over the top or just sort of...
Yes.
Like I mean, average working man?
No, no, more.
Silly drinking,
but not embarrassingly silly. I mean, the guy could hold his alcohol. He used to drink a lot of vodka. He was never an embarrassment to me as a publican. I was, you know, the guy in charge of the pub. He was never embarrassment whatsoever. He never picked a fight. He didn't, if anything, he got silly when he drunk instead of aggressive. So there was no problem at all. I was in the pub with him many, many, many hours, and I never... It was alcohol all the time. It was vodka. And I used to buy vodka... I mean, our sales of vodka went up from, like, a case a week to 5 cases a week.
Although Brian's problems with drugs were well known, it was alcohol which eventually took its toll. Here, Burke recounts an unfortunate incident which occurred after Brian cycled down to the hay wagon on his newly customized motor scooter.
I think it was a Saturday. He had, like a Lambretta, you know. And he drove down one lunchtime for some drinks, and obviously he had a lot to drink. But once again, no problems, no big deal. But when he got on to go home, he had a crash. Right, he crashed across the road.
Is it that little sweet shop in the paper
yeah,
news agents?
You've seen it, yeah, Woods Stores. And
did he go right through the window?
No, he didn't go right through, no. But, I mean, we could see what was happening. I mean, in retrospect, I suppose I should have... Yes, I suppose I should have stopped him and driven him home.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you know, he was a very happy sort of guy. He wasn't legless, because he was, obviously, alcohol-induced. It's... You don't feel the same reactions as if you're kind of cold sober, you know? So it wasn't a major thing. He just got out of control, crossed the road, and straight into the shop, okay? So he's on his side, and us guys were looking at him and saying, you know, Jesus Christ, you see that? Come on. And so we go out there, and he wasn't particularly injured, but he was injured enough for hospital, you know, for some treatment. But just to show that he wasn't a complete alcoholic, he was cosmetic enough to say, hey guys, look, get me to the hospital, but don't tell anyone my name. And we said, okay, right, yeah, no problem. We took him off to the hospital, and they didn't know who he was. He could have been anyone. They didn't know. Patched him up. He wasn't badly hurt. It was just scratches and bruises. And we took him home again. Now, he was internally... grateful for that, because of obvious reasons. You can imagine what the media would have. Oh, yeah. He wasn't hippie or anything. He was quite neat and tidy. He was nothing but a charming, confused young man. Too much money, too much success, been rejected by his band, parents, and he was just lonely. He was lonely.
Finally, Dennis remembers his mate Brian as a gentleman desperately in search of a home.
I'm in a new place now, I'm part of the community, and I must behave in the right way. He was trying to correct the image that the media and living in London had caused him, bad press. And he was a good boy, he just wanted to be a good boy.
After the initial rush of media attention, Brian felt interminably alone and defeated. The Rolling Stones, though, rolled right on, bringing in Mick Taylor on lead guitar. The quiet, affable Taylor fitted the bill admirably. Not only was he a great player, but he was just the kind of easygoing, non-confrontational junior partner that Jagger wanted after so many years of having to deal with the unpredictable and volatile Jones. The pastoral sameness of life in the English countryside seemed to agree with Brian. Since buying Cotchford Farm, he had personally overseen to the old estate's much-needed renovations, as well as taking a lot of care in furnishing the main house with a collection of exquisite antiques, tapestries, and period paintings. To aid in the work, Brian hired a crew headed by a local contractor. Initially, things went well, but as time went by, Jones could sense a brewing hostility amongst the workers. "Some days they hide my motorcycle," Brian confided to his friend, Nicholas Fitzgerald. "When I'm on the phone, the line will suddenly go dead. Then when I get the engineers in, they say there's nothing wrong. They're always leaping up to answer the phone, and then they tell me it's the wrong number. I just can't trust anybody. I know you think I'm paranoid, and maybe I am, but not about this. I know they're up to something." Ronnie Money, a longtime associate of the group, remembers the prevalent mood at Jones' upmarket Elizabethan digs. All those months they'd been really sucking Brian dry. They'd all been living off him, faking bills, not doing their work, drinking his booze, all that stuff. People who suck off you don't like you. They hate you, really, because that's what makes it so easy for them to suck. Brian was foppish. He was rich. He lived luxuriously with beautiful young women. A chauffeur drove him about in a Rolls Royce, and these construction guys resented him for that, sneered at him. Interestingly, Tom Keelock sees things a bit differently. It is his contention that Brian, job foreman Frank Thorogood, and the erstwhile builders were all the very best of friends.
"I know everybody that worked for Frank. Yeah. Unfortunately, Frank's dead now. Died a couple of weeks ago. But everyone he employed, he trusted. They kept their mouth shut. Brian used to make them at home, have a drink and whatever. Sure, but when they went away, you'd never hear any of them talk about him."
"Brian didn't mind the builders? He got on with them?"
"No, he got along with them famously."
The culmination of this uneasy alliance between Jones and his new employees came late in the evening on July 2nd, 1969, when the contractor, his lady, and several of the crew showed up after work with their girlfriends for an unscheduled party. That afternoon, Brian had dug out his saxophone and stood alone in the timber-lined cottage, playing in concord with the rustic bustle of rural Sussex. It would be his final concert. Later in the evening, surrounded by the beer-drinking laborers, Brian sipped some wine and made small talk with his guests. When everyone scattered out to the pool, Brian changed into his trunks with the intention of taking a swim. Diving into the 80-degree waters of the floodlit pool, Jones felt suddenly revitalized and before long was showing off on the diving board for the young ladies present. Standing on the side of the pool, two, as of yet, unnamed workers began loudly taunting the blonde musician, obviously jealous over the attention he was receiving from their girlfriends. After a few minutes of what might still be regarded only as aggressive beer talk, the pair jumped into the water and began physically harassing Jones. An eyewitness to the events of that long-ago, sultry summer evening, known only by the alias of Marty, remembers what happened next. "I wasn't really paying much attention at first, just that they were poking at Brian and roughing him up in the water, and a couple of the girls said, 'Let him alone, will ya?' But that just made these lads pester him all the more. Then Brian tried to get out of the pool, but they wouldn't let him. They just kept pushing him back and pulling him under. These lads really got worked up at Brian the more he resisted. They were dunking him and then holding him under the water and keeping him there, and then letting him up only for a couple of seconds, and he was gasping, and then down again he would go. I could tell it was turning ugly as hell." By now, things had spun way out of control, with Brian struggling helplessly to reach the surface. Obviously frightened, one of the fellows holding Jones panicked and screamed for the other guy to let him up. Only seconds later, someone yelled out, "He's drowned!" Within seconds, everyone ran for their cars, leaving Jones to sink slowly to the bottom of the pool. "Sink like a stone," Marty grimly thought to himself. "I always thought he was okay, but there were those he rubbed the wrong way, you know, and it all just seemed to get out of hand that night." Over the next few days, everything of value was systematically stripped from Cotchford Farm. By the time anyone thought to lock the place up, there was nothing left to steal, and Brian Jones lay in the morgue awaiting an autopsy at the hands of yet another faceless stranger. To all the world, Brian was just a pretty boy pop star who suffocated on his own hedonistic appetite for self-destruction. The truth is, Brian Jones was viciously and senselessly murdered by a couple of drunken laborers, the ultimate victim of the violent, ruthless, and self-interested forces that molded him. Brian Jones never found even a hint of justice or mercy, not in his sweet short life, nor in his murky, murderous death. Dr. Cyril Wecht, the world's leading forensic pathologist and a celebrated attorney, reviewed at the request of this author the official autopsy, the police reports, and other relevant documents pertaining to Jones' mysterious death. What follows is a brief summation of his findings.
Well, after I reviewed the materials regarding the death of Brian Jones, with particular interest and concern on the autopsy report and the coroner's discussions, I believe that it does appear to be a death due to drowning. The findings of a positive nature, specifically frothy fluid around the nostrils and some slightly blood-stained fluid in the mouth, the heavy wet lungs, all of these things would fit with a death due to drowning. The absence of any other significant pathological finding also fits in, that is to say, in drowning deaths, it's sometimes just as important to negate other possible causes. They talk about the liver being somewhat fatty or even extensive fatty degeneration. This certainly suggests chronic alcoholism. There are other causes of fatty liver, but not very many, especially in someone of Brian Jones' age. And he was a little obese. Obese people can have some fatty change of the liver, but not extensive changes. However, sometimes we say fatty livers can result in sudden death. That's usually in chronic alcoholics, people who are in a poor state of nutrition and whose health is bad and so on. It's not a diagnosis or an etiology of death that I would consider at all in this case. He had a 0.14 alcohol level at the time of his death, which is significant by itself.
It's not roaring drunk, though, is it?
No, it's not a lot. And for somebody who does a fair amount of drinking, it really would not have produced any significant compromise. A chronic drinker can handle a 0.14 alcohol level. You and I, other observers, might not even be aware that such a person had done any drinking. I can't rule out the possibility that one or more people may have brought about his drowning by playing games with him, continuing to dunk him, pulling him under, making him begin to swallow water. And then after a while, of course, even though you may be a good swimmer, as Brian Jones purportedly was, if you are not permitted to breathe, and if you begin to swallow water, then you may drown.
Could two very strong people hold them firmly under the water without bruising a person?
Sure, absolutely, absolutely. And they could certainly dunk him and push him under without bruising him also. So, no, I don't think the autopsy rules that kind of a situation out at all.
The newspapers and by and large the world has this concept that Brian Jones was some kind of junkie that just got too loaded and fell into a swimming pool. But the drug blood barbiturate levels and blood alcohol levels and urine samples and the various reports in here, they don't indicate to you that he was like incredibly intoxicated either on alcohol or drugs.
No,
is that correct?
They did report an amphetamine-like substance in the urine, but you know what's in the urine doesn't count because that's already out of your system, and that has no effect on your brain at all. So as far as the autopsy findings are concerned and the toxicological analyses, there's no reason to attribute his death to a drug overdose or to even suggest that drugs played any role in his death.
Do you think Brian Jones died from some kind of asthma attack?
It's hard to say. I don't agree with the statement that doctor made. an asthmatic attack is going to seal the bronchi and prevent water from getting in. It's true that in an asthmatic attack, you get some bronchospasm, but it's not spasm that is complete, that seals it off like some kind of a trap door. I don't find evidence in what is set forth to suggest that he had an acute asthmatic attack. Furthermore, then, if we look at it from the standpoint of his being a good swimmer, and we've already discussed the fact that he was not under the influence of drugs and so on, no reason why, if he had had an asthmatic attack in a swimming pool, that he would not have been able to simply get over to the edge and get himself out. After all, he was not swimming the English Channel.
In a 1994 British publication, Who Killed Christopher Robin, Tom Keelock fervently maintained that it was his old friend Frank Thorogood who was directly responsible for Brian's death, a view he didn't seem to hold when I interviewed him in December of 1993.
You don't think Thorogood did anything wrong, do you?
No way.
If he had, what would you have done?
I'd have gone mad.
Would you kick the shit out?
You wouldn't think so. No, Frank, I've known him for 50 years. There's no way. He looked after him. See, his job was very difficult. Not just a builder. He had to keep all them away. He never opened his mouth. And he just really kept an eye on it. If he thought Brian was coming around, he'd phone me. Doesn't matter, day or night, he'd phone me. He said, well, look. See, two or three times, like, he wanted this ordered and one ordered. And he said, well, Brian, you don't really want to do that. It's going to cost this and cost that. And Brian was very money conscious, like, you know.
You mean to throw it away or tight?
Well, he didn't have a lot, like, you know.
No.
And with Brian, when he had something, I would send a bill to the office as if, like, oh, that's all right kind of thing, like, you know. And Frank said, well, I think you'll spoil it. And when I want it done, so Frank said, well, phone me. I said, what do you think? I said, well, if he wants it done, he wants it done. Then again, Brian had changed his mind too many times. I'll tell you here and now. Frank left him to get a cigarette. He was swimming, so I'm going to get a cigarette, Brian. I said, okay, he was on the end of the pool. And he'd... First of all, he said to Frank, look, I've had a couple of drinks, he said, I've had a few brandies. I'm going to swim. So Frank said, well, I wouldn't advise it for you. No, no, I'm all right. That's for 5 minutes. And Frank left to get a cigarette. And Janet Lawson, she was a nurse that was a registered nurse fund, was there. And she said, where's Brian? He said, well, it's Paul. Well, keep your eye on him. He said, yeah, I'm just going to see. I'll go back when I come back. When he come back, boom, he looked around, looked in the pool, and he was up this end, the end towards the, what's the name? So he probably got from one end to the other. And personally, I think it was booze, pills, and he probably had an asthma attack.
On November 7th, the Stones officially began their sixth U.S. stint playing the State University at Fort Collins, Colorado. The next several shows went smoothly enough, culminating in a Grand Prix concert on December 6, 1969, at Altamont Speedway in Livermore, California. Supporting the Stones that fateful afternoon were Jefferson Airplane, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, the Flying Burrito Brothers, and the riveting salsa-inspired Santana. Being close to San Francisco, the open-air show was jam-packed with over 500,000 enthusiastic fans. Vocal advocates of the New Left, the Stones shunned the security force normally used at such events in favor of the San Francisco arm of the Hell's Angels. Although the mass of incense-burning hippies generally tolerated the redneck bikers, they didn't really like them, and unfortunately the feeling was mutual. Adding to the tension was the unhappy fact that so many spaced-out people in such a restricted area created impossibly long lines for everything, from hot dogs and soda to dope. By the time Jefferson Airplane took the stage, small pockets of insane brutality were beginning to break out all over the teeming humanity gathered to pay obeisance to the Stones, sending waves of incomprehensible terror rippling through the sweltering, tripped-out crowd. Altamont was rapidly becoming the great disaster predicted by everyone's parents as the inevitable wages of the uninhibited hippie lifestyle, so disdained by middle-class America. It is well known that the ultimate transgression to a biker is for anyone to mess with his bike, which unfortunately also occurred. It was the unmistakable beginning of the end. Ian Stewart remembers the inevitable controversy. The Altamont catastrophe took place in December of 1969, as the 60s came to an end. As far as I was concerned, Altamont was the death knell to all of the things we thought would last forever. That May, the Stones and Ron Wood, or Woody as he was affectionately known, played together publicly for the first time on a decorated flatbed truck rolling slowly down Fifth Avenue in New York, staged to promote their upcoming tour. The unprecedented series of gigs were to last a whopping 3 months, transversing not only the States, but South America as well. Holed up in a rented mansion with the band in Montauk, Long Island, Woody worked frantically to master the Stones' extended set of 34 powerhouse tunes. During a rehearsal, Jagger accidentally stuck his hand through a plate glass window and opened a nasty wound requiring some 20 stitches. "It was a bit messy," mused Jagger later, "but I won't need a cast or anything." Ron Wood officially became a Rolling Stone forever and always on February 28, 1976. 2 weeks later, the band went back out on the road to resume their world domination of the touring circuit. On June 20, 1980, a new single, Emotional Rescue, was issued from the album of the same name, released just 3 days later, to rave reviews and brisk sales. That autumn, another 45, She's So Cold, backed by Send It to Me, was hustled out to a similar response. On August 25th, 1983, the Stones made rock and roll history once again by signing the biggest, most potentially lucrative deal ever with the multinational CBS Records, raking in a cool $25 million advance against royalties. On Halloween Eve, the Stones officially presented the world with yet another new single with Undercover of the Night and All the Way Down. Their new album, Undercover, was then released in both the U.S. and U.K. A period of relative tranquility settled over the band throughout the spring and summer of 1987. In May, all five Stones gathered at the Savoy Hotel to discuss future plans for the band. Though he would never publicly admit it, Jagger was now operating from a position of weakness. Not only had his two solo albums bombed, but an American tour already booked was canceled in anticipation of poor ticket sales. On top of that, a planned autobiography, for which Jagger had reportedly received a handsome $100,000 advance, was deemed unfit for publication and scrapped. His Majesty, as Keith liked to dub his big-lipped buddy, had suddenly tumbled from his throne and there was nowhere else to go. Mick Jagger needed the Rolling Stones. 3 months later, a victorious Mick was telling the press that the Stones would soon be going into the studio to record a new album, and a tour would follow. But as Jagger flew off to Sydney for his 17-date Australian tour beginning on September 22nd in Brisbane, Keith Richards' long-awaited solo album, Talk Is Cheap, was released. Unfortunately, old wounds were opened, this time with Keith seizing the opportunity to answer Mick in song as with the track You Don't Move Me. Meanwhile, rumors were swirling as the Stones gathered in Barbados in January 1989 to discuss a possible reunion album and tour. Richard, still basking in the success of his solo venture, had to be talked into the meeting by his manager, Jane Rose. No one, in fact, seemed able to predict just what the Stones would actually do. The sessions were duly filmed by television director Lorne Michaels of Saturday Night Live fame for a documentary entitled Return of the Stones to be broadcast during the band's upcoming tour. On July 11th, before a media barrage of 500 reporters and scores of exhilarated fans, the Rolling Stones arrived by train at New York's Grand Central Station in an open-air flat car to announce the Steel Wheels Tour, named after their forthcoming album.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mick Jagger, Keith Richards, Bill Wyman, Charlie Watts, Ron Wood, Rolling Stone.
Hey! Good morning. Good morning. All right, Bill? Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for coming. We know it's hotter than hell in here. Is it?
Yes. Yes, it is. I'm sorry we kept you a little bit waiting. We won't be here forever, so we just get it, do we, quickly. We're very pleased to announce that we're doing a big tour this year, which starts in September the 1st in Buffalo and goes on, and I think you've got all that in little bits of paper, yes? And we've got a new album which comes out the last week in August, I think, or maybe the first week of September. Yeah, yeah. And that's called Steel Wheels, and the first single's called Mixed Emotions. I know you're dying to ask questions like, will this be the last tour you ever do? That's a good one. Or what's another one? How much money are you going to earn on this tour? That's a good and the other things like that, but I won't preempt you completely. But do fire away. If you want to ask any questions, I think you should just do it. You like that?
Yeah, thanks. Mick, I'd like to ask one question. There have been a lot of rumors about who's opening up on this tour. Was it going to be Guns N' Roses? Was it going to be In Excess? But now it's going to be only Living Color? Or what's the deal with opening acts?
It's a negotiation.
Are there going to be other opening acts besides Living Color?
Yeah, a great group called The Negotiations.
We're going to have Aerosmith and Boomtown Rats and Guns N' Roses and that sort of band. You know, there's got a certain something about it.
Living Color.
No, there will be, seriously, there will be some other acts in some places. But I will be announcing those later.
Are there any other questions out here?
Mick, with all the hype and all the rumors that we've been hearing about the fighting between you and Keith, the stuff that was on the cover of Musician, how are you guys doing now? What's the truth? What's going on? Everybody's happy?
The answer to that is we both gave up Massacre.
We don't have fights, we just have disagreements.
So everybody's happy now?
Sure.
And I'm hot.
Well put. Anyone else?
Yes, Mr. Jagger, you had mentioned money yourself, and there has been quite a lot of talk about how much you would make on this tour. Some rock critics have charged that the only reason you're doing it is for the money.
No, that's a who.
Who said that? Who said that?
What about love and fame and fortune? Have you forgotten about these important things?
We're doing it for the glory, darling, the glory.
I got a question for Keith. You said you always wanted to see what rock and roll was going to be like as you got older, into your late 40s, early 50s. Well, you're there. What are we going to see that's different on this tour that we haven't seen before?
I could answer that better in December, I think. But at least I'm going to find out, right? A good bit of live music for a change.
Anyone else?
This is for the whole band. How would you describe the energy level 25 years ago to now? Same?
Ask my wife.
Sorry, what did you say?
Hello, Mick. How do you feel after you were inducted to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame last year by Pete Townsend? Do you plan on doing the same for The Who?
We'd love to give it to him. No comments?
I think we've done enough for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Back in 81, and this is directed to Mick, they had an article in Life magazine about some of the training, physically, you went through all this training. What about this time around? What are you doing to prepare for the tour?
Well, I'm walking around Manhattan at the moment. I don't know, you should do a little bit, but I don't think I'll overdo it. You know, I think I've got to take it easy, so I don't think I'll overdo the training. Just a little slow walking and
quick shopping.
Across the Himalayas.
Is this your last tour? Is this finally your last tour?
No.
Oh, yes! Thank you!
It had to come.
Brilliant. Who was it? Thank you so much. That's a wonderful
question. You tell us.
First asked in 1966. No.
Mick, is there any significance in you announcing the dates of this tour just before the anniversary of you starting the band in 1962, which occurs tomorrow when you did a gig at the Marquee Club? Is there any significance to that? Are you listening?
Yes.
I wish there was.
Very good point.
We didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
Wonderful historical.
I lost my diary.
This tour is not a historical tour as such, it's more of a 1989 tour. You know, I mean, I don't see it as a sort of retrospective or farewell or anything like that. I see it as the Rolling Stones in 1989.
You said we were dying to ask you this, and you're right. Why now get together for the Belmont tour?
Why not?
Can you elaborate?
I can get very elaborate, but when you got the guys together, then you take it. You know, I mean, these guys. If I can find these four, same as Nick. If I can get them all together, I'll do it.
This is the first of the extended tours, as you've said, many more. Are you going to have supporting cast, people like Bobby Keys and that? Are you going to invite other people to go on tour with you? You're going to have a whole cast of characters?
You want a towel?
I hope so.
We're working on the guys, the rest of the guys that will be with us, but there will be other guys with us, yeah, a few. We got Matt Clifford.
All right, great.
and Chuck Lavelle.
What about your fans down under, Mick? We going to see you in Australia?
Well, yes. Last year I was there, but we hope to go all around the world in one day. But who knows, Australia might yet get its turn.
Okay.
Last time we checked in with you, we saw you at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Since then, you've written an album. How did you write the album? How was the writing process done?
It's very hard work.
Very quickly.
And where?
In the islands, Montserrat, Barbados. For the winter, you know, something to do.
Keith, I'll have you take this one. If you were an 18-year-old rock fan, would you want to go see a 27-year-old band in a stadium or a young up-and-coming band in a club? If you had to spend your $20 on one or the other.
It's not $20 in a club.
It would depend how good they are, man.
Keith, are there any songs in this album that you're singing the vocals
on?
Yeah,
a couple. Two. Yeah.
Thank you. You recorded the album a whole lot of around the world. Did we get any of those other influences in the music on the album? Why did you do that in all those different places?
Well, it was only in the recorded it in the West Indies, and it was done very quickly. I think
5 weeks.
Thing about the record is it's very compressed. It's done in a very quick time. It's got some rough edges. It's got a lot of different things in it, and we hope you like it.
Mick, a couple questions. One, can we expect to hear any of yours and Keith's solo material on this tour? And two, could you compare this tour at all to your 1981 tour?
Better than 1981. More mature, more rocking, more hard, more steel wheels. No solo material.
And better dressed.
The Who just did a whole bunch of Tommy on their tour. Is there anything special that you might be focusing on?
Are we going to do our rock opera?
The new opera.
A new opera. We'll do our new opera.
New opera?
Yes.
Are you better as the Stones as a group as opposed to individually? Do you feel like complete when you're the Rolling Stones?
Do I feel complete? I feel like a sort of...
It's a group.
Sinker speed. Well, one more question because my mascara is running.
Go ahead.
I have one more question.
What is the album title mean? Is the album title refer to hip hop scratch DJ turntables or is it trade?
Sorry?
Little easy question.
What was that?
What's the title refer to?
The title of the album.
Yeah.
Steel now boarding Rolling Stones on track 22. All aboard! Yeah. Thank you very much, everybody.
Okay.
Thank you for coming. Sorry it wasn't too hot. Bye. See you there.
Rolling Stones.
Just 2 days before their first concert came the eagerly awaited release of Steel Wheels, the band's 34th album. Produced by Mick and Keith, many feel that this album conveys the original drive, soul, and sense of fun that energized the band in its glory days of the 60s. As the Stones barnstormed throughout North America, conquering every major stadium in Canada and the States, raking in millions, it appeared that they could do no wrong. Despite all the media glitz, however, something far more profound was happening up on stage. On the surface, they looked and sounded very like the same old Stones, grinding through classics like Painted Black, Brown Sugar, and Sympathy for the Devil. Why, Mick even broke a long-time vow never to perform Satisfaction again. Following the Steel Wheels tour, the Stones embarked upon an ambitious series of shows they called the Urban Jungle Tour. Once again, they met with the press to firm up the particulars of this exciting series of gigs.
I'd like to apologize, and so would they, for the rest of the band that just couldn't be here today. Bill Wyman has a sort of love-hate relationship with the British press. And, just couldn't make it. He's in France. And Charlie Watts and his wife are spraying wild animals in Africa. And who else? Ronnie Wood is losing money very heavily, I've heard. That's why he's had to do this European in Ireland on racehorses. And Keith is in America with his family. And he told me, I think something, what was it? Oh, no, don't forget the music. There will be music. What else was I saying to you? We're very pleased to be doing this section, the European section. You know, Britain's our home country, Europe. We're looking forward to doing it. We haven't done it for a very, very long time. The show, we're very kind of... We chucked out the Steel Wheels thing. We thought a year of that was enough. So we redesigned the stage and we're doing this Urban Jungle thing, which will be completely new.
Hi, Mick, I just want to know for our European audience, obviously, how different the Urban Jungle Tour is going to be to the Steel Wheels Tour that the Americans saw.
The stage is completely different. The staging, the music, a lot of songs are going to be similar. And we'll be doing songs from every period, from the beginning to the end, so to speak, or up to the present day. We will change the musical focus a little bit. I don't quite know exactly at this point, but it will be somewhat different show. Well, we're all in the business together, I think you'll find. We've got our sponsorship, you've got your advertising in your magazine. Rock and roll's been business for a long time, I'm afraid the days were gone, just it being an amateur thing, I don't even remember those days, I'm afraid. But, I think that underneath all that bullshit and the sort of fanfare, which is what we're doing here today, it's still the same music underneath it all. I say, well, it's just another gig, but of course it's your hometown and where you started, and it's got all these sentimental attachments, and you've got to do your best show. So I hope that the Wembley show is going to be a real art concert. I hope that all... No, I can't stand up from all the members of the band. I'm going to turn it off now. It's going to be a really up concert, and I think it's going to be a great one. I hope it doesn't rain, and everyone has a great time.
Any chance of you moving over to take Ronnie out for a race or something like that in Ireland, Mick?
Where do you want me to go? Livingstown or somewhere?
Are you looking for...
That's where Ronnie is. I'm not going to join him there.
What are you going to do when you're over there? You going to stay for a while, go to a few races?
No. I think it would be... tricky business. I like to keep it under there, but maybe come back in the autumn for a bit of that. We never really set out to be the baddest. Just want to be the best at what we do. I think that on the last 70 shows, I think they were pretty good standard. I think they were the highest standard Rolling Stones shows that I've ever been to. I don't know about you, Mike. I've seen some bad days, but they were really good, and I think this tour is going to show that the Rolling Stones still can deliver. In a way, it's easier now, but in some ways, because it's more organised than it used to be. In other ways, it's more strenuous, because when I was 20, we only used to play 20 minutes, and that you were off. Now you play 2,500. Every time you tour, it gets longer and longer and longer and longer. And you think, well, what's the attention span of the audience that can be this long? But obviously, you have to be in pretty good shape to do it.
A steady favourite with bands both young and old, the Stones continue to roll on. I spoke with Aaron Comos of the Spin Doctors at Woodstock 94 about the legendary group.
They're one of the greatest rock and roll bands of all time, and we're going to be opening up for them in the winter, so I'm really psyched.
Have you met them yet?
No, can't wait.
Now we are into the 1990s, and the Stones are entering their fourth decade together. Nobody yet knows what demands the final years of the 20th century will make on us, but whatever they are, the Stones should at least have a good sense of what is needed, and chances are, just like they've always done, they'll deliver it right on the money.
Part 3. Back in 1996, Brian May, Charlie Watts, and Paul Rodgers collaborated together in Rock Therapy, recording the song Tie Your Mother Down, featured in Return of the Champions. In August 2021, the Rolling Stones announced that Charlie would not continue the U.S. No Filter tour due to a heart problem and was temporarily replaced by Steve Jordan. Of course, sadly, he died on August 24th at the age of 80. Following Charlie's passing, Brian shared his feelings on social media.
They asked me to go on breakfast TV and stuff to talk about him. I kind of don't feel qualified. I don't feel that I should be sitting there pretending I'm an expert on Charlie, because I did work with him and I did know him, but there are a lot of people who knew him a lot better than I did, so I don't feel like I should be there pontificating. But seeing as we're talking, yeah, I feel very, very sad inside losing him, because he was just... Well, unique, completely unique, with that wonderful jazz influence, which kind of you wouldn't have thought would fit with the rock music he played, but somehow it did.
Charlie's surprise passing was a blow to countless music fans all over the world, but especially to those whom he called a friend. Amongst them, Paul McCartney.
So sad to hear about Charlie Watts, the Stones drummer, dying. He was a lovely guy, and I knew he was ill, but I didn't know he was this ill. So lots of love to his family, his wife and kids and his extended family, and condolences to the Stones. This will be a huge blow to them because Charlie was a rock.
On September 29th, 2021, Mick Jagger made his first live public utterances on the passing of his great friend and colleague, Mr. Watts. This is some of what he had to say.
It's a heartbeat, you know. I mean, Charlie was a heartbeat for the band, you know, and also a very steady personality, you know. He's a very reliable person, you know, wasn't a diva, you know. That's the last thing you want in a drummer. You know, I miss Charlie because, you know, he had a great sense of humor, and we also were outside of the band, you know, we used to hang out quite a lot and have interesting times going. We like sports. We'd go to football, we'd go to cricket games, and we would have other interests apart from just music. But, you know, of course, I'm, you know, really miss Charlie so much, you know, being up there playing. And every time we get together now and rehearse, we always think, oh yeah, and Charlie would say this and that. Then he would do that, and then he would. I mean, he was a very quirky guy, and you know, we really miss him. But you know, we did so many shows with him, and so many tours with him, and so many recording sessions. It's you know, strange being without him.
To a high-flying bird. Now that Charlie is gone, the mind wanders back over his gentle, benevolent reign as perhaps rock's preeminent drummer. In a non-stop, frenetic tsunami of activity around the Rolling Stones' bombastic persona, Charlie was its one real constant. He was, by all accounts, a quiet, inward, unassuming, humorous, charming, and faithful man. His great power was invested in his humble everyman persona, as well as his mile-high talent and intrinsic ascetic aplomb. Find me a person who has anything bad to say about Charlie. A rather remarkable accomplishment after having traversed the face of this fickle earth for some 80 eventful years. Charlie had a keen artistic eye. He too was a lover of fine, carefully crafted things. An accomplished horseman, patron, father, husband, friend, and seasoned musician. While important, these are still only attributes of a man, albeit a good one. But who was Charlie really? And who are we? If it is as said, we all emanate from a wellspring of light and love from somewhere deep within the burning heart of a benevolent universe, then we all have a place at the table of life. And thereafter, every expectation of an involutionary return to the original source from which we all sprang. A trip through life, perhaps many lives, in which we seek to find the most elemental, primal, and just manifestation of our seminal being in time, space, and beyond. In that sense, the birthright of each and every one of us is assured. The interconnectedness of life leads us all eventually back to our sweet home as a spark of the fire, a drop in the ocean of the vast, unlimited, original, quiescent self. It is more than fitting that we couch our celebration of the life of Charlie Watts in such a high-minded, philosophical, spiritual way. Because Charlie was a signpost, a reckoning of all that is right in this wildly uneven world of wickedness and death. He was even, sustained, present, and yes, constant. He was an unflickering flame in a wild, windy world. The rhythm of life plays on in his music, the beat of our hearts, and the tonality of our lives, hopes, and dreams. A man from humble beginnings, but at the end of life, a rare, seldom seen, and immensely beautiful high-flying bird. And in that, we can all take a profound lesson in living from Charlie. Godspeed, my friend.
I mean, I always consider myself a drummer, you know, and so that's the key at the time, and help everybody else do what they do, you know.
Jeffrey Giuliano is the author of some 30 internationally best-selling books on the Beatles, John Lennon, and other iconic musicians of the 1960s. In 2006, his book, Paint It Black, The Murder of Brian Jones, was made into a film by Stephen Woolley and Nick Powell entitled Stoned, The Wild and Wicked World of Brian Jones. It remains a cult classic and the only film bio of the Rolling Stones. Giuliano is also a veteran journalist, having written for dozens of high-profile newspapers and magazines, including The Sunday People, The Daily Mail, The News of the World, The Mail on Sunday, Playgirl, and Rolling Stone. A noted film actor, Giuliano starred in such movies as Vikingdom, Scorpion King 3, Jules Verne's The Mysterious Island, The Fifth Execution, Far Cry 3, Fire Desire, among many. In addition, he hosted the long-running North American syndicated radio series Jeffrey Giuliano's Roots of Rock for 5 years, as well as pioneering the audiobook industry in the 1990s by authoring, narrating, and producing over 250 original, non-book-based, interview-driven productions. Giuliano's publishers included Random House, HarperCollins, Delta Entertainment, Durkin Hayes, Playaway Audio, Speechworks, and B&B Audio, among dozens more internationally. In 1998, Random House acquired his firm Tribute Audio, for which Giuliano acted as CEO and publisher for 5 years. His best-selling audiobook, That Fateful Night, True Stories of Titanic Survivors in Their Own Words, was nominated for a Grammy. In 2014, Jeffrey Giuliano founded Icon Editions and G2 Media Arts to market his updated works as well as publish new projects. As a visual artist, Jeffrey has been showing in galleries across America since 1977, garnering impressive reviews. His first professional assignment was designing several t-shirts for The Who's Pete Townshend in 1976. Jeffrey also designed and illustrated many of his original rock biographies for the biggest publishers in the world from 1984 to 2006, as well as designing for his pioneering record label, Samba Records in the mid-1990s. From 2006 to 2011, Jeffrey was also the primary designer for the French fashion house Cotai. When Giuliano first conceived of creating his own literary imprint, Icon Editions, he became responsible for illustrating and designing 35 book covers, several hundred CDs, DVDs, as well as dozens of promotional posters, and eventually, an entire collection of exclusive fashion and art. The expansive Design by Giuliano brand grew out of Jeffrey's impressive commitment to the arts and is the culmination of a lifetime's work by an extraordinarily talented and determined Renaissance man.
Your host and narrator, Jeffrey Giuliano. We hope you've enjoyed this Icon audio presentation. Icon Audio Arts. Thank you for listening.